Hello YouTube and welcome to the sixth video tutorial about Anatella. I am Frank Vandenbergen, CEO of Timi. In the previous video, we learned how to import data, how to transform data, and how to use the cache mechanism to create and debug the most complex and the most refined data transformation. We learned all that by using a very small example, and let's go back to this example just now. So, close that. Okay, maybe you notice here that I let two boxes here on the side. These boxes do not hurt the speed or the performances of Anatella in any way. So there is absolutely no harm at letting these two boxes inside the graph. No worries. Actually, I really like to have these little boxes on the side. Let me explain that to you in more details by giving you a small example. Let's now go back in time and return to the time when you were using Excel to do some very complex computation. And I'm pretty sure that most of you were already in the situation of a very complex Excel sheet. And at some point, you feel a little bit lost and you decide to use one cell on the side to rapidly do a quick computation to check something, just to be sure that everything is okay with your computation. And only then you can continue to work on your Excel sheet, knowing that you are right on track. Actually, this little cell on the side that you are using in Excel is very important. Without it, you don't know if you are going in the right direction. And you see the little boxes here on the side, they have the same purpose. They are not useful once the data transformation graph is finished and running properly, but when you create a new graph or when you debug a new graph, they are really useful, just like the little cell on the side in Excel. So don't hesitate to use this little box on the side. There is absolutely no harm at letting them inside the graph, and they really help you to solve and debug the problem at hand. Let's now assume that I finished developing my graph, and I am now ready to put it in production. So I want my graph to run every day at midnight, for example. Let's also assume that the final objective for this graph is only to produce an Excel file. More precisely, I really don't want to create a bar chart here or to run the raw filter box. I just want to execute this white Excel box to get my Excel file and nothing else. So does it mean that every day I need to wake up at midnight to click this precise pin there? No, of course not. This is the exact moment where the little box with the finish line flag that you will find here in transformation run control is becoming really useful. So I'll put it here. So what I did, I just connected my right Excel box to the finish line flag to tell Anatella that the objective of this graph is to create my Excel file and nothing else. Now, because of the finish line flag, Anatella knows exactly which boxes it needs to run at midnight during a non-interactive, unsupervised batch execution. It's actually all the boxes connected to the finish line flags that will run. In this particular example, Anatella won't run the histogram box and the row filter since they are not connected to the finish line flag. Then, at that point, I can configure any scheduling engine to safely execute this graph automatically every day at midnight. And I don't need to manually click anymore there on the output pin of the right Excel box. Actually, you can use any scheduling engine to run your Anatella graphs automatically, but we usually advise our customers to use Jenkins, because Jenkins is very easy to use and to set up, and it's fully integrated with Anatella. Furthermore, everything in Jenkins is 100% in self-service, with the mouse, no code. It's web-based and it's free. Jenkins is really a full-fledged scheduling engine with thousands of options and plugins. It has all the features that you need, plus some more. please refer to the section 4792 of the Anatella help file to know all the reasons why you need Jenkins. This finish line flag box here is also very useful when you have a very complex project. Let's illustrate that on two examples. So this is my first example. So as you see, it's just a complex project with Anatella. This graph is really big and involves many, many boxes. When you are trying to solve a very complex problem, it can happen that your graph grows to such a gigantic size. And don't worry, Anatella can safely execute such a huge graph. The problem is not inside Anatella, but rather on the support and maintenance side. This is because the graph is really large, and finding an error might be really difficult in such a large graph. Ideally, this graph should be split in a series of smaller graphs for easier maintenance. In technical terms, this graph needs a refactoring. And this is exactly what our second example illustrates. Let's open our second example. Okay, this Anatella graph starts from the raw data table from a telecommunication company. More exactly, it starts from the CDR files, the call data record files. And it computes a large table that is typically named a customer view. In this example, our customer view is a table with more than 1,000 variables where each row represents a customer. Inside this graph, the order in which the boxes are executed is defined by the order in which the boxes are connected to the finish line flag box, to this box. This means that Anatella will execute first this box, and then this one, and then this one, and so on, and so on, and so on. You should know that the process to compute the customer view is really quite long and literally involves hundreds of small boxes. But you don't see all these boxes here. Instead of having one gigantic graph, we have a series of smaller Anatella subgraphs. And this box here is used to launch the execution of all these smaller subgraphs. You'll find this box inside the transformation run control category. You can see just here below all the subgraphs that will be executed by the parallel run boxes. And if you right-click one of these graphs, so let's do that, let's right-click a box, okay, you can directly see and edit the subgraph. Please note that it's very important that each of the subgraphs contain exactly one finish line flag box. Otherwise, you cannot run the subgraph using the little parallel run box. You can also see here that I am running several times the same graph. Actually, this graph is parameterized, meaning that it contains some global parameters. And if I redefine these global parameters before running the graph, as I did just here, the graph will compute completely different outputs. Basically, for those of you that are used to code in Python, Java, or R, it means that our Anatella subgraph is actually a procedure or a function that you can call using this little box there. And you can define all the value of the parameters that will be used when calling this function just here. The parameters that are given to a subgraph are actually named global parameters. And they are defined just here inside the subgraph. So you go to Edit, Graph Global Parameters, and you can see all the graph global parameters, meaning the parameters of the subgraph. So you can execute subgraph using the parallel run box, but you can also execute subgraph using many other boxes, like this one, the parallel box. With this box, you basically create a loop, and this loop can execute using all the CPUs inside your machine. Or you can even do better, you can execute subgraph using this other box, and this means that the execution of all these subgraph will be distributed amongst many different computers. In technical terms, this is called distributed computation. So let's say that you have a cluster with 100 nodes, then you can use all these nodes using this little box there. I'll now illustrate how you can put a graph in production. Let's assume that I need to run my graph every day using the Jenkins scheduler. The procedure to install Jenkins is really easy, so I won't explain it in this video. For more information about installing Jenkins, please refer to the section 47921 of the Anatella help file. And you can get the help file inside Anatella by pressing F1. So let's start. So close that, open Jenkins. Frank. So I'll add a new job inside the scheduler. So I'll click new item and give a name to the job. So let's call it demo. I select freestyle project, press OK. Then I'll scroll down to the bottom to build here. And I select execute Windows batch command file. And here I need to, okay. So I just entered two lines here. The first line is telling Jenkins that Anatella must execute the graph name d.document.tuto.anatella.tuto.anatella. The second line here is telling Jenkins to ignore the warnings messages originating from Anatella. Actually, if I omit this second line, Jenkins will treat all the harmless Anatella warning signals as critical errors. That's not good. To tell Jenkins to run this graph every day at midnight, now I can go to build periodically here, and I write at midnight. At midnight. Okay. You can actually enter a very complex schedule here. There is a complete documentation on this subject inside the section 47923 of the Anatella help file. Then I just click save, go back to dashboard, my demo is here, and now I can execute the demo just by clicking this little box there, and it runs the demo, and after a while, I do refresh, it turns blue with a little sun. Everything went okay. But I still want to have a look at the content of the Anatella log window, so what I'll do, I click demo, go to the last execution, and I can have here the output of the log window. If you want, you can now pause the video and put your graph in production using Jenkins. Congratulations on learning how to put a graph in production. You can now proceed to the next section of this tutorial. To do so, click here. Bye!